Folks, I have with me Mr. Vittal Kamath. Mr. Vittal Kamath is an engineer. He's a biomedical engineer from MIT Manipal. After his engineering in biomedical, he left for US and he completed his master's in ergonomics. After completing his master's in ergonomics, he was in Middle East in a biomedical company. And after a brief stint there, he thought he'll have to switch his stream, and he moved on to the automotive industry. Then he worked for the Mahindras. Once he started working for the Mahindras, he shifted his base to Europe, and he served there for a very long stint. But always the town of Udupi was calling him back, and he thought that, okay, I'll have to come back to my native place. So he came back to Udupi, and he was always a foodie, and as he was into business development, and he had an opportunity to, multiple opportunities to visit various restaurants throughout Europe along with his clients, and he had seen how the hotel industry functions, and he was a foodie also, so he underwent some training also. Then he thought, why not start a unique restaurant in Manipal? So that's how he started his new venture in Manipal, that's the Chef Plated. So my visit to Chef Plated was incidental. Dr. Rao, who is a physics department faculty in MIT Manipal, who is one of my close friends, he is always one person who takes me to various new places. So that day when we were going, and he told, look, there's a new hotel that has come up. And incidentally, Chef Plated had completed 1 year before that. And the teachers don't venture into many places. So we saw towards our left, and we entered the Chef Plated. That's how I entered the Chef Plated for the first time. And then it was always my next office room after my MIT, because my lunch is there. I take it with Vittal. It's not that the only food that attracts me, it is the intellectual, the discussions that we have during our lunch and during our coffee that attracts us to Chef Plated. And there are many unique aspects that are related to Chef Plated. So I thought I will have to share these unique aspects related to Chef Plated with my students and make it into a case study. And Vittal always tolerates me. Well, I keep asking him questions, he keeps answering me. I thought, okay, I'll ask a few more questions in front of the camera. That's how Vittal is here with us today. Welcome, Vittal.
Thank you so much. It's an humbling experience listening to what you have to say, but happy to be here nevertheless.
Vittal, since the audience would be most of my students,
okay.
It will be more sort of an academic sort of a discussion.
Sure.
So let's start with the naming of your hotel.
Okay.
How did the name Chef Plated come to your mind?
Mm-hmm.
And how did you start designing your logo?
Sure. So the thought process was to be very different. Different from anything that I could observe in Manipal. Then it had to go from the level of the logo to the concept to the food, the menu, and the overall experience. So in Italy, where I've worked for the longest in my entire stint in Europe, food was considered to be an artwork. So the way they talked about food, or they ate their food, or lived through the experience of food, was very different for me growing up in a town like Udupi. And I have visited several countries, worked in several countries, but Italy attracted me the most, because being in business development, wining and dining was a way of life, but Italy took it to the next level. I am not going to say that I am recreating anything that I have ever experienced in my life, because that is not possible in a place like Manipal. But I thought, let me be different. So let me elaborate. I didn't want to do anything fancy. I didn't want to do anything out of the ordinary. Just something a little hutke, if I may. So I went about the entire town observing other people, what they are doing. So I said, okay, I missed a place like what I have created when I was a student. and I would want to create something that is different for the students out here right now. So it began with the location. I didn't want to take up any commercial spot. I wanted to create something from my own brainchild. So a commercial spot was out of picture. I looked at residential properties. Everybody advised me don't do it because it's an Herculean task. First of all, finding a homeowner who is willing to give you his home is next to impossible in a place like Manipal. I was almost giving up on this dream when incidentally I found a gentleman who was ready to do that. Then I told that gentleman that this house will never look like what it used to be. He was fine with it. So once I locked the property, then the creative juices started flowing. So whatever inspired me during my various travels, just put that down to sketch and you see what you see, how I've done the place. So the biggest challenge then was to make an Indian house look like not completely European, but quasi-European or semi-European, what have you. I feel I did whatever I could to achieve that. Then the logo. I am a big fan of studying logos, so subliminal messaging was something that I knew that I will incorporate into the logo. So if you see plated, the 8 is in the plate, which made a whole lot of sense to me then. I don't know if people get it, but that was the thought process that I had when I designed the logo. And the food. I observed that in most of the restaurants in Manipal, it's either khao piyo jao, like you eat, you pay, you leave. There were very few places where one could stay back, relax, have a good conversation, chat, have a discussion, or you perhaps go with your laptops and work there, or just read a book, spend a couple of hours doing nothing. I couldn't find that. Of course, you have your coffee days, but then it's not the same experience. I never liked AC restaurants. For me, it always felt claustrophobic. So AC was also out of the picture. I wanted open air. I wanted clean air. So it had to be a little away from the noisiness of what a conventional commercial spot has to offer. I feel I achieved that also. When it came to the menu, I thought let there be names that people have not heard of at all. So that way again I am distinguishing myself from the competition. So of course pastas everybody serve, but I said okay, I will serve it al dente, the way it should be served. It should be 80% cooked, undercooked. And it was a risk, but I took that risk nevertheless. And when I opened the place, I didn't even have a menu. Conventional wisdom tells you to do so many things. Now it takes a crazy person like me or a stubborn person like me, I don't know. But I'd never listened to any conventional wisdom and I opened it the way I wanted to open it. Building the place organically was very important to me. So coming from a marketing background, working for a big corporate house like Mahindra, I never marketed my place.
What I see is, I don't see any of your ads in Manipal.
Exactly.
And from my earlier discussion, I know that you believe in word of mouth.
Yes.
But don't you think the organic growth with help of word of mouth is much slower than the conventional way of advertising?
It's slower, but it's more effective. Now, you need to take a judgment call. I was a student here. I have eaten here my entire student life. You are a student, you were a student here, you are now working here, you have been here your entire life. And time has shown us that only a handful survive in the restaurant industry. So the names that survived or thrived during my time are the same of your time and maybe for a decade ago before us and a decade later after us. I'm just observing. So those who made a name for themselves have been there, will be there, or going forward also will be there. But what about the new names? They come, they go, they come, they go. Now, what is a common feature amongst all of these? They start with a bang. The minute they open, you will see flyers all across town. The minute they open, you will see boardings all across town. The minute they open, any university, any college, some event is happening, they are sponsorship all over town. So, what, 40 square kilometers, Manipal? What is the need for advertising? It's not like anything over here is an hour away, or there is so much traffic that it's difficult to get anywhere from point A to point B. Anything, anywhere is as the crow flies. So why advertise? That is point number one. Again, this is my logic. Second, you need to be very confident of what you are doing if you do what I have done. So when I hired my chef, he asked me for certain things which I have banned from my kitchen. Now, if these things exist in my kitchen, that means I'm doing something fundamentally wrong. And these things are bad for your health. They don't exist in my kitchen. Now, if you are used to eating Ajinomoto, you will not like eating at my place. If you know what Ajinomoto is, it's a good thing. If you don't know what it is, please research what it is. Now, tasty, delicious is all subjective, but quality is not subjective. So I focused on the bare minimal, which is quality. If you do quality stuff, then, and if it's very different, nobody has heard of these dishes, then why advertise? Then it's a risk, because everybody is multi-cuisine, and I am claiming to be bistro, continental, but I have dishes based on my personal experiences. I've eaten it somewhere during my travels. I have had a Spanish friend, he gave me a Spanish recipe. I have had Mexican friends, they gave me a Mexican recipe. I have Italian friends, they gave me an Italian recipe. I have collected all that, concocted something, and put it in my cafe. So if you like what I have done, if you've eaten the food, if you appreciated it, chances are you will tell a similar minded person to go and eat there. When that happens, you are doing my marketing at no cost to me, which helps me maintain quality. Now, if I had started this cafe when I was 20 years old, maybe I couldn't have done this even if I wanted to, because the pressure of, you know, economics or finances, and it will kill anybody. I don't have that pressure right now. And I can wait. I can wait, because doing the right things need to go at the right pace. So that's the logic that I'm going with.
The first thing what I noticed after entering your restaurant was your menu, which had no prices in it. And what's the logic behind that?
If you have to understand that, you have to understand what I did 1 year prior to you visiting my cafe. When I opened my cafe, there wasn't even a menu. So I opened a restaurant with no menu. And I was the talking, walking menu. I had only four dishes, four vegetarian dishes and four non-vegetarian dishes. And because I didn't advertise, and because I didn't let anybody know I exist, and like you said, your visit to my cafe was incidental. Only incidental people entered my cafe, and it was a wonderful way for me to interact with the end user, talk to the person, describe what we have in mellifluous language, if you and tell them what it is, and so they are visualizing something. So that is the extent that I went to. For first 3 to 4 months, if not longer, I didn't even have a menu. I would just orally tell the people what I'm offering, and they would eat and they would go. Then came a point that traffic started increasing. Then I realized I can't do this anymore. I have to come up with a menu. But still I was figuring things out, so it went a natural way. You know, you call it stupidity or genius, time will tell, but I did it anyways. Then when the traffic increased to a level that I couldn't talk to each and every person, every single dish, I came up with one A4 sized paper which had the name and the description. That's it. Still, it did not have any price. Then traffic increased, and then I realized that, okay, if I do this, then again I have to spend a lot of time and energy explaining stuff, and the end user might not get it or might not be appealed by it. So eventually, I did food photography. Still stuck to the basic that it should not be an extensive menu, not 150 dishes, just 8 vegetarian, 8 non-vegetarian pastas, limited choice of starters, and limited choice of desserts and beverages. So you have seen my menu. It's the bare minimalistic there is, but the food photography is actually a clear representation of the what the plate will come and sit on your table. So while doing that, if the customer doesn't know what a moussaka is, a customer doesn't know what a cannelloni is, and some people actually have difficulty pronouncing certain
Like me.
names. No reflection on what people know or don't know, like a Worcestershire, okay? Nobody's heard of the sauce. So, if you've never had it, if you don't know what it is, and if I put a price there, what meaning is it for you? Rather, I took the risk of saying, okay, you eat this, understand this, and then if you like it, come back. If you don't come back. But if you do, please tell somebody that you liked it, and that like-minded person will come. For me, that is organically growing the business, which is what I did. If I may, I'll go several steps before whatever I did. My logic to opening a restaurant in Manipal was that this place is immune to online food delivery companies. My research told me that Foodpanda came here and folded in 6 months. By that logic, I realized that okay, maybe nobody else will come because Manipal is not even a tier 3 city. I don't know if it's still a tier 4 city. So maybe the conglomerates will not come over here. And I opened the restaurant. But now you see what you see. It's a virus infestation that has crept in everywhere, all over India, and it is destroying businesses all across India. But then what one must realize is all the essentials for running a business in the food industry. If you stick to the basics, everybody makes money. You don't need these guys. You don't need shortcut methods. And the end user must realize that cheaper, faster, convenience is not something that maintains any dignity of, you know, what a business should sound like or mean like. I don't mention my prices. I don't advertise. I don't have the best location. I don't give discounts, which is what everybody else does. Upon that, I don't do home delivery. Now, prima facie, you are talking to a village idiot. Prima facie, I shouldn't be open anymore. Everybody else is doing it and crying. I am not doing it and I am happy.
On your pricing strategy, I know it's very difficult to spell out in open, but I think some of it, so because my students will get that gain.
See, pricing anything is not rocket science. Now, I have done pricing for
I'll
service.
just interrupt you. I think most of your items listed there are almost of the same price or same price.
Everything is the
Every,
same.
everything has the same price. Then how does it work out? And what's the pricing strategy behind it?
Now, everything is the same price because if you have 150 dishes and you play, I don't know what everybody else's logic is behind pricing whatever they do for whatever reason they do. When you don't put a price in your menu, it is simpler if everything is the same price. So I hope I answered that question. Now, how does it work for me? Okay. Pricing anything anywhere is not rocket science. There are some dishes which are your bread and butter in any menu. There are some dishes that are there to appeal to a larger audience. There are some dishes to appeal to a very niche group of people. Now you are doing something and total random strangers are coming to your place. You can't please 100% of the people. You try and do whatever you can to please as many as you can, but you will never be able to please 100% of the people 100% of the time. That is one thing that I'm completely keeping inside my head when I do anything. See, you need to remember the basics. One, you need to keep wastage in mind. You need to remember that not all the raw materials are priced the same throughout the year. So it fluctuates up, it fluctuates down. But you keep the up and price the menu. Three, unforeseeable things like power outages leads to wastage other than the natural decomposition of whatever produce or meat that comes into your kitchen. Four, maybe for some reason, during some time, there is a religious festival or whatever, and you have not kept that in mind, and people don't eat as much non-veg as veg, or not as much veg as non-veg, and that leads to, you know, an imbalance. All these things need to be kept in your mind when you do your pricing. I kept these things in my mind, kept a buffer, and kept a pricing. Then I am a big, big, big believer in the 80-20 principle. 80-20 principle can apply to anything and everything.
So you are a Pareto fan.
Yes. So I know 80% of revenue of mine comes from 20% of the dishes in the menu. So if I am very diligent in keeping those 20% of the items ironclad that it will make me money, then I price everything according to that with a buffer. Because nobody can predict the future. You have to be safe. Okay, so keeping all this in mind, I lose money in some dishes just because I want to keep standard pricing. But I make money in some dishes. But I know where my 20% is coming from.
And other day during discussion, you told me about your one-third principle. Can you tell me more about that?
No, one-third is not my rule or my principle. One-third, one-third, one-third is a global phenomenon, but it's not a written in stone kind of a rule.
You can call it as a thumb rule.
It is a thumb rule, and okay, 30% or one-third of your pricing for any dish in your menu should cover infrastructure costs. One-third should cover the food cost, raw material cost. One-third should cover your gross profit, okay, which will then be taxed upon at the end of the year. There is GST and whatnot. So this is a thumb rule that everybody, if they know, it's good.
Do you think people in your industry are following it? Because I see 50% of, 60% of, with this logic, will this one-third, or the 33.33%, will it work out?
That's why I said you are talking to the village idiot. I have run my numbers, and I have run my numbers left, right and center, and I have not been able to crack this. Now, I am a solitary person in whole of Manipal who's never done online delivery. You, even if these guys come to me and pay me money and say that you take our money but we will deliver your food, I will never do that because I know what their end game is. It defies logic how you can do online delivery and survive. So let me put it in a very simple way. I have a relationship with you. You were a stranger to me before you came to me. Now you and I meet as often as we meet because you come to my place. Now there are many such Dasharaths there. I have a direct relationship with my customer. Logic dictates that if they come to my place, I serve them food, I make the most profit. Why am I incentivizing them to sit at home when it costs me more money to make them sit at home and feed them at home? If anybody can answer that question to me, the village idiot is enlightened. Two, if you come to my restaurant, I feed you, there is no middleman. Now I am giving whatever percent to that middleman. Why do I need a middleman? I am very greedy. I'm very greedy. I want my own money so that I can feed my wife, kids, and take care of their future. So that, if anybody can explain to me, the village idiot is enlightened. Next. Now, I like control. Everybody should try and control their own destiny. Why should I put my fate into somebody else's hand? If they don't deliver on time, if something happens, who is responsible? So that means my fate is in somebody else's hand. They mess up, my reputation is lost. Nobody will shout at them. They will remember an bad experience with you. Another logic. If you cannot own your own customer, why are you in business?
You could just have a kitchen.
Yes.
Don't need a restaurant.
Why do you need infrastructure cost? One third of your food pricing is infrastructure cost. Then why the hell are you opening, spending a hell of a lot of money and decorating your place and putting ACs and doing all these things? You shut down that place and open a cloud kitchen. But then cloud kitchen is again another virus which is infesting this place. That's another discussion altogether.
I think we'll have to have a separate session for
that.
Yeah,
we'll need to have a separate session for that. I'm completely against that. I never eat at a place where I cannot see the kitchen. I have an open door policy. Anybody that wants to see my kitchen can go see my kitchen. Only thing I don't let anybody do is take pictures of my kitchen. But anybody can go and enter my kitchen and see the kitchen. So, coming back to this, if anybody, your students or the other business owners can enlighten this village idiot, I will be very thankful. Another logic I will give you. And this is hardcore fact which nobody can, refute. Simple math, let's say, with whatever infrastructure cost, whatever resource cost, food cost, and whatever margin you think is acceptable for you, you come up with some pricing and you set your menu. Pre-online delivery days, whatever money you made, okay, keep that in one corner. You know your numbers, put that in an Excel sheet. If the online delivery has given you incremental business, it's fine. Let's say you made X, and let's say because of online delivery, you get 10% more than X, is fine. If it becomes in the next month, 20% of X is incremental business, okay, fine. Let's say X here and X here, very good. You make more profit here, less profit here, but combined you have made more money. But is that what is happening in real life? Answer is no. You called me here today, call every other business owner, not just from Manipal, from anywhere in India. I'll tell you what is happening. If your X was X, after Swiggy and Zomato, the size of X becomes 90% of X. And then this increases, this decreases, this increases. So your in-house is decreasing, which was giving you more money, and your online is increasing, which is not giving you that much money. What logic is that? Are you a factory then? See, no food manufacturer can call himself a factory. You cannot. It's not like creating shampoos or televisions, or like you increase the number and nothing will get affected. When you have a confined space and you have limited staff, you cannot increase that beyond a certain number. Why is everybody unhappy today? Because they are not making enough money. Something is fundamentally wrong. Either everybody else is seeing things that I cannot see, and if they come and enlighten me, I will stand corrected.
Since you brought in the word factory, I remember something about factory or manufacturing. often there is one term by Gary Hamel and C.K. Prahlad about the core competency.
Mm-hmm.
Now everything related to food is your core competency, but I see your pantry is outsourced. What's the logic mm-hmm. behind it?
That's a different story altogether. There is no this thing there. Whoever is running my pantry is a very good person. Father and son runs that pantry, and see, it's end of the day, it's people. They are nice people. They believe in doing good. They believe in.
Of course, I'm a big fan of their products. Yeah, it's a different question.
Yeah, so they, it's like I'll concentrate on my food. I found somebody who will concentrate on the beverages side. They are also in the same page as me. Very little, but do it nicely. Don't do anything fancy. Don't go out of the way and mess things up. So it's something that works, and it's an outside. It's they are not related to me, but now we have a business relationship where they operate under my roof, but it's a good symbiotic relationship.
So there is no idea as such.
No. It's just somebody who I help them out. They help me out. It's gone beyond a business relationship.
Okay. Now, regarding your operations, would you share something related to your operations? Maybe the people you hire or number of people you hire or something like that, which you would like to share?
See, nobody likes to do too much. Everybody wants to do less and earn more. Had online companies, aggregators not come to Manipal, I would have ideally kept more people so that I work less. Now, if I am a lazy person, then I am doomed. Thankfully, I am not a lazy person. Thankfully, I don't have dignity of labor. I had a very, very nice white-collar job where I only wined and dined with C-levels of companies, VPs and presidents of companies. I only ate at fancy places. I drove fancy cars. But when I'm in my own hometown, I don't look at my past and say, I will recreate that over here. Dignity of labor in my mind, you have seen me operating, so you know what kind of a person I am. So I am doing the work of four people. And because I am doing the work of four people, each and every staff of mine does the work of four people. Now, this is something that a culture, if it should exist in any establishment, big or small, it comes from the top. So the onus is on me to see what kind of a culture I create in my own in my own restaurant. So when I am working so hard, nobody in my staff can say, this is not my work, that is not my work. Because if I am doing everything, everybody does everything. This helped me because in such a cutthroat industry where margins are wafer thin because a lot of unnecessary things are happening, is helping me a lot. Because I have the leanest staff. If you see the number of seats to the number of resources and take the ratio and compare mine with any other business in Manipal, you will never find anybody coming close to mine. I have a staff of 6 or 7 people, that's it. And I have a 100-seater. You go through all the restaurants, all the cafes, big or small, you will not find this anywhere else in Manipal. Now that is something that I'm not boasting about it, but it's something that came inherently to me that I should work hard so that my staff works hard. And because my resource count is down, I am able to survive.
Regarding your sourcing of materials, I'm asking all your business ideas, okay? would you like to share something about how you source materials and how you're going to make what's an optimal way of sourcing materials or the raw materials sort of?
See, I have challenges that not many other businesses have in Manipal. most commercial spots have commercial kitchens. I don't have that luxury. I opened my restaurant in a residential property, which was then converted into a commercial property. So I have constraint of space. So I need to be very, very diligent in what I source, how I source. So there are most things that I source according to the day. There are,
so you call it just in time in hotel industry?
Not exactly to the way that just in time means vis-a-vis any other
but
industry.
Anyway, the whole overall, the soul of it is that.
Yeah, soul of it is that I cannot, I don't have the luxury of space. So everything needs to be planned a certain meticulous way so that there is no wastage. So it's sourced according to that. It's not something that if I could avoid it, I would. But I have to do it because I can't. I can't afford to not do it.
Now, even in social media, I think you are very active in Instagram. And I don't see the same set of activities on Facebook. How do you differentiate where you will have to be more active? Is there any specific reason? Or do you like Instagram the most?
Ideally, I wouldn't want to be in any social media whatsoever. But I am against every social media, but that's a different discussion for a different day. But I see that for some reason everybody wants to take a picture of their food and everybody wants to post it somewhere. Facebook, according to me, is the epitome of all evil in this planet Earth. I feel that Facebook should be not just banned, but the company should be disintegrated.
Oh God.
but nevertheless, Instagram is something that is owned by Facebook. But it's sad that I'm using Instagram. I'm not happy I'm using Instagram because some of my core clientele are on Instagram. So I do it. Facebook gives me a lot of grief and aggravation because there is a lot of fake news, a lot of propaganda, a lot of nonsense activities there, which I don't believe in, so I'm out of it. But Instagram is a small window for me to get a glimpse of what is happening in my end user's life, a glimpse of what they are also doing when they are not at my place. And one small way for me to put something out there when I release something new so that I can attract somebody in. Now, it doesn't cost me, so it's fine, because my motto is simple. My logo exists within my property, not outside, so I don't market or advertise, and this is something that I don't spend on. Anything that I need to spend on compromises on quality, which I will never do. So it's a free thing, so I do it.
Dear friends, I think we had a very informative and enjoyable session with Mr. Vittal. So now I think we are coming to the last part of our interview, where I would like Vittal to give a message to the budding entrepreneurs.
It's keep things as simple as possible. There are only a few things that one must take care of if one wants to be an entrepreneur. It's you know it and you teach it better than me. And
I often tell my students, a teacher always draws a salary, so he's not a right person to teach entrepreneurship. I think a teacher should have at least burnt hands, or at least invested in something for him to be able to teach entrepreneurship in a better manner. So I think in horse's mouth it sounds better.
For every entrepreneur, coming to the most basic and root level, I don't want to say anything complicated or fancy. It begins with an idea. Now that idea, whatever merit it holds, makes or break the case for the entrepreneur. Even if the entrepreneur comes up with a bad idea, it's fine because it's a failure. And if it results in a failure, that entrepreneur has learned something. So something that, if not repeated, only helps the entrepreneur. So number one is idea. Number two is capital. I tell everybody and whoever is willing to listen, don't start anything with a loan. Now, if you don't come from a background where you have the finances to start anything, then work somewhere else. Have financial discipline. Collect money, save money, and then start something. This is not applicable 100% of the time, and it doesn't mean that if you've taken a loan and started something, it is doomed for disaster. Don't take me wrong. But as much as possible, stay away from loans. In the tech space, this is not possible at all. And not all tech space deals or visions and missions of whatever anybody is doing is bad. But overall, many of them are. That's a different discussion. Number three is the team. And the team, by I mean anybody and everybody that is working for you or with you or however it is. The stronger the team is, the better the chances of your success. So when a team is formed, whatever dynamics of that team is, whatever the culture of the team is, however hard or lack thereof there is for the team that is functioning, is all up to the entrepreneur. Never take that lightly. Lead by example. What is number four? Execution. For execution, I always say, look far ahead, reverse engineer what you need to do today. Then you will come up with an execution plan. Then each and every day, each and every week, each and every month that passes by, cleanly, clearly, objectively assess yourself whether you are on track to achieve what you envisioned yourself to be or do 3 years, 5 years, 10 years from now. And do that diligently. Don't kid yourself, don't fool yourself. What is number five? Number five is something that you can never ever control. That is your destiny. Or you call it time. So you can come up with the best idea, but if you have started it too prematurely, it is not good. If you have started it too late also, it is not good. Let's say my own example. All these five things. Now the idea. Idea is Continental Bistro Cafe. Now, had I started it when you and I were students, now the element of idea and element of time, the first and last thing I mentioned, it would have been a huge disaster. Because when I was a student, if a place like Chef Plate had existed then, it was a bad idea then. It might be a good idea today, I don't know. It might be a better idea tomorrow, I don't know. But that time will tell. Fifth point which I said is destiny also. I am combining time and destiny. Because if you have to fail, you will fail. You can't control that. Finances. Now, I am able to do all these things like, you know, grow it organically or not have the pressure of EMIs and blank loans and everything. Had I started it then, maybe I would have been under all those pressures. Today, I don't have that. But when you have a loan, It makes you do things that you might not want to do. Okay? Team. Now, I gave you a clean example of how I am trying to create the culture in my own establishment. You work hard, then everybody will work hard. So, all these things, these are very, very simple things. It's not rocket science. Business is actually very easy. Everybody complicates it, that's the biggest problem. And we've had several discussions where we've talked about it and said that common sense is the most uncommon thing to find anywhere.
With this note that entrepreneurs need common sense and common sense is uncommon everywhere, we try to conclude our discussion. I thank Vittal for making the session very informative. Today we came to know how the restaurant business works, how the aggregators are disrupting the way how the restaurant business is going on, what the customers need, the importance of quality, the importance of having a well-defined processes and so on. We would be coming out with many more informative sessions with Vittal, and we are in the process of chalking out things. I hope you enjoyed our session today. Thank you, Vittal.
Thank you so much.